Good morning. Here we are yet again for another lovely session of CENG 4412 Steel and Concrete Design. So this is going to be the 10th lecture in the video series, and we're continuing on some of the material I posted very late last night at past midnight. So I guess the students in class right now will not have had a chance to review through those videos. But for our purposes here, that's going to be hopefully okay. Today we're just going to do an introduction to the code approach to steel beam design. In other words, the AISC code approach to steel beam analysis and design. Now, so in the previous videos, in lecture 9, the three videos of lecture 9, three parts of lecture 9, we looked primarily at the sort of theoretical development or the theoretical models of steel beam design. So I went into the assumptions, the equations. I dredged up some old equations from mechanics materials, reminded us how this stuff works. Really looking at steel beam design from a purely first principles mechanics materials type analysis. So we looked at, again, as a review for mechanics materials, we looked at fully plastic beams that were loaded under the elastic limit, over the elastic limit, exactly at the elastic limit, between elastic and plastic, and at the fully plastic state. So four states altogether. But anyway, let's move on and see how the code handles things. Okay, so let's start looking at a code approach to steel beam design. So steel beam design code approach. Steel beam design code approach, or AISC code approach. Okay, so the guiding chapter for this, if you want to go to page 16.1-44 in your AISC manual, assuming you have the 15th edition, that is chapter F. So the guiding chapter for this is going to be chapter F, which covers beam design or just flexural design. So again, we're looking at chapter F. Chapter F, design of members for flexure. Design of members for flexure. For flexure. Now, if I want to go then and look at some of the subparts of this, there are various sections within this chapter. Again, this is going to be found on page 16.1-44. Again, assuming the 15th edition of the manual, but there are of course many different editions out there, but all of the last several editions will have chapter F being your flexure chapter. Section F1 is going to be some general provisions that you can read about here. We'll see that CB later that's probably perhaps the most important part of this. But also another important thing from section F1. Section F1 is your general provisions, and the first thing that's going to be important is your phi. Your phi is going to be 0.9 for flexure. So whenever we're designing steel beams, we're going to be using a resistance factor of 0.9. So that's the first important thing in the chapter here. And then we also have something called CB, which we will look at later. That's the that is a constant or a coefficient to deal with non-uniform moment. We'll explore that later. I don't want to get to that today. Okay, so where I want to focus our efforts today is F2, section F2. Let me actually just go ahead and write how it describes this. The manual says that F2 applies to doubly symmetric, so I want to write out the whole thing and then sort of parse this or break this down and see where this particular subsection applies to. So doubly symmetric, compact I-shaped members, and channels bent about their major axis. That would be the strong axis bending that we talked about in the last video. Bent about their major axis. Their major axis. So basically this applies to a couple things. One, it would apply to doubly symmetric members. So that could be an actual I shape if you could still have one of those lying around somewhere. Or it could apply to a W section, or maybe Really any kind of section that has a general I-type shape, something like this. As long as it's symmetric top and bottom, if you cut this off and made it a T-shape, then this chapter would not apply. You'd have to use another section in the manual, or in Chapter F. And it also, though, applies to, it will also apply to, say, C-channels, like this. C-channels, again, will look something kind of like this, just a general C-type shape. Just two flanges and a web. And as long as this is symmetric, you can apply the provisions of Chapter F2 as long as you're bending about the major axis. So again, we're talking bending about here or bending about here. Now, we need to also consider the, so again, that's the definition of major axis. So we're talking about major axis bending in this chapter. So bending about the XX axis, as we discussed in the previous discussion of, as we discussed in the previous discussion of, or I shouldn't say discussed in the previous discussion, as we illuminated in the previous discussion of strong versus weak axis bending. Now, we also need to, everything else is fairly straightforward, except this word here, compact. What does that mean? What does compact mean? That is a word you may not have heard before. Well, you've definitely heard the word compact before, but it's probably not the word a word that you've heard a lot in, at least in this particular context. So first of all, in terms of shapes, the general idea here is this is going to mainly apply to hot-rolled shapes. These are generally, if I look at compact shapes like this, it's generally going to be hot-rolled shapes that will meet these criteria. So we're generally talking about hot-rolled W-sections, C-channels, etc. Now, when I say compactness, that has a particular definition. So let's talk more about compactness. And when we say compactness, or when the code says compactness, what it's referring to is a geometric relation or a geometric measure of slenderness for a particular element. So compactness, you can have compactness of many things. You can have compactness of a web, you can have compactness of a flange, but basically it relates to the slenderness of an element. The slenderness of an element of a cross-section, of a cross-section's element, or of one of a cross-section's elements. One of a cross-section's elements, and let me maybe draw out a W section here to kind of illustrate this. So if I have a W section, something like this, and I could have a variety of elements on this, a variety of things I would define as elements. Well, not really a variety, really just two. So the first elements, the two elements that I might look at, one would be the flange, and one would be the web. And so when I say something has a, so I could say something has a compact or non-compact flange. In other words, this would mean if a flange is compact, I would be asking a question on how slender. In other words, what's the length to width ratio of the flange? How slender is that flange? Or if I asked, is a web compact, or do I have a compact web? I would be asking, how slender is that web? Again, in terms of length-to-width ratios. How slender is that web? And the reason this is important is, think back to, say, Euler buckling. Think back to mechanics materials. And if you remember in mechanics materials and or structural analysis, and actually, we'll see this a bit. Actually, we'll be seeing this not too long when we start looking at our column unit. So this will be a bit of a review for that. But when you have a column, if you have a long, slender column, it does not fail in crushing. You don't load the column up in axial load to the point where it just crushes across the cross section. Instead, what happens is a column tends to buckle. It's just going to bow out and buckle and collapse that way. Or if you have a column that is, say, braced in the middle. If I brace it in the middle, like this, and then I apply an axial load to it, what it tends to do is it tends to buckle more like this, sort of an S shape. And the point being that if we've learned or in the past, or you've seen in mechanics materials, that the allowable load on a column is going to be dependent on its unbraced length or its buckling, its relative buckling strength, etc. Now, the interesting thing about this, though, is think about this, though. Think about when you have a beam, the top flange, at least in positive bending, in a beam, if you have a beam that's in bending, like this, well, of course, as we saw in concrete and you've seen in other classes, the top flange is going to be in compression, so negative for compression. Top flange will be in compression, and the bottom flange will be in tension. So we don't have to worry about buckling as far as the bottom flange, or at least assuming positive bending the bottom flange. As far as the tension flange is concerned, in other words, we're not going to be concerned about buckling. But if you have a flange, imagine I created a really weird beam. Like, let's say I made a beam, a really weird, poorly constructed composite beam. Like, let's say I took a beam, I made a weird custom cross section that maybe the web is made of cardboard and the flanges are made of steel. I don't know why you would build such a thing, but let's say you did. Let's say I built up a member, like a really weird member, that its flange was made of, that its flanges were made of steel and its web was made of cardboard. So we have effectively a massive amount of strength in the flanges and almost zero strength in the web. Well, let's say I could somehow get this thing to not fail and shear. If I could somehow put this thing into bending, what's going to be the limit state for this? What's going to be the limit to its bending capacity? And the limit to its bending capacity, if I can somehow prevent it from failing and shear, is going to be this upper flange. If you think about it, what's going to tend to happen is, this cardboard web is not going to be able to do it, again, because if you think about this flange here, this upper flange that's in compression, it's effectively a large column. It's under compression. It's basically a giant column. And so obviously if I try to brace that column with a cardboard web, it's not going to be able to resist buckling. It's going to immediately buckle. But as your beams, if you have very slender flanges, very long, slender flanges, even in that case, in that case, you're of course not going to have a literal cardboard web. Your web is going to be able to provide substantial buckling resistance. But if you start putting this thing in buckling, you have a tendency for the flange itself to buckle. So, like, if you have a very slender flange, again, everything made of steel. If this thing is under high level of compression, you can actually get buckling of just the flange. The flange itself can buckle out like this, just sort of pop out up to the side, even without the web itself failing. If you have a long, slender flange, the flange itself can buckle just like a column under compression loading. Okay. So based upon this, we are then going to classify, we need a way to classify sections as compact or not compact. So basically when I say compact shapes, when chapter F says doubly symmetric, compact, I-shaped members, et cetera, when they say compact shapes, they are talking about W-sections or C-channels, et cetera, that do not have compact flanges, that do not have compact webs, et cetera. They're talking about elements that pass certain compactness requirements. So compactness is a buckling limit state, is the key to remember here. Compactness is a buckling limit state. A buckling limit state. So if I'm going to continue on with this, I then want to consider how we actually calculate, how we actually tell whether a given section is compact or not. So if we want to apply section F2, again, F2 is going to apply to only compact shapes, compact, doubly symmetric, etc., but applies to only compact shapes. So with that in mind, we need a mathematical way of determining, okay, what exactly, how do we, if I give you a section, how do we actually determine if that is compact or not? Only compact shapes. So what does this mean? Well, this is found in actually in section B 4.1. So the compactness criteria. These are found in B 4.1. Section B 4.1. And that should be page 16.1-18 in the 15th edition of the manual. And so there are a whole bunch of compactness requirements that we use in various locations around the steel manual. On the previous page, 16.1-17, actually let me just, maybe I can list all of these. 16.1-17, this page, this deals with compactness for compression members, for columns. And we'll be looking at that later on. Compression members. And 16.1-19 talks about compression elements like flanges. Actually, it's the same table as before. It's just continued on, but here we're gonna. It does have a W section listed on that table. They are talking about webs there. But anyway, the case that we are looking at here for chapter F, the relevant case, at least for doubly symmetric, actually for all chapter F2, for chapter F2 or section F2, I should say, the relevant case. And so basically they have a whole, as you go through the table, they have a whole bunch of different cases. So for example, case 12 is legs of single angles. Chapter 13 is flanges of all I-shaped sections and channels bent in the minor axis, weak axis bending, et cetera. But for F2, what we'll be looking at is the relevant case. The relevant case here. Would be, let's see, the relevant case would be case 11. So this says, again, case 11 says, this states, flanges of doubly symmetric, so just to sort of give us an idea of how we pick our case out as we're going through this, and it states that that this case 11 applies to flanges of doubly and singly symmetric. My 11 looks like quotation marks. Of doubly and singly symmetric, I-shaped and built-up members. So we ought to be using that there. I-shaped built-up members, or built-up members, and it tells us that the limiting ratio is B over T. And so basically there is a B over T ratio. So what determines whether something is compact is B over T, the ratio of B over T. And this is talking about the B over T for the flange. So you can look at the drawing there, but basically when it says B over T, we're talking about the, not the B as in the beam, not B as in the overall BF, the B sub F in the chapter one, for example, is going to be your overall flange width. This is sort of half the flange width. It is the width of just one part of the flange, one half of the flange. So if you look on the drawing, look on the little sketch there, you will see that B is defined as just from the center line to the edge of the flange. So this is our B here. This is B here. And T is the thickness of the flange. T is this thickness here. So we're looking at B over T. That's our limiting ratio. And then we'll need to compare it. We'll compare to two quantities to determine whether it is compact, non-compact, or slender. Compare to, and I will sort of draw, give these values, and I'm going to sort of sketch out where these kind of come from. I'm here. Oh, actually, that should say, oh, this is, oh, man, I made a little error here. Sorry about that. That should say chapter 10, or sorry, case 10. We are not talking about built-up sections. We're talking about rolled sections. Rolled sections. Sorry about that. Helps if I give you the correct case. Of rolled I-shaped sections. I-shaped sections. Sections, channels, and T's. Thankfully, the same B over T still applies. Sections, channels, and T's. Channels and T's. Maybe we'll fix that in editing. Or maybe not. And T's. Here. So that still applies, but then we will still compare this to two limiting ratios. And these ratios are as follows. We'll have 0.38 times the root of e over fy. And I will rewrite these on the next slide, so. And 1.0 times the square root of e over fy. And this is capital FY, not lowercase FY. Okay, so again, these are our limiting ratios. So what we're going to be doing is we're going to be calculating the B over T, that we're going to be calculating the width of half a flange divided by the thickness, and then comparing that ratio to limit states. So basically here, if I create a graph, let me create a rough graph here. Let's see. So again, I'm going to use these as limit states to determine whether I'm in a compact, non-compact, or slender case for my webs, or sorry, for my flanges. Okay, so if I have B over T, on this axis, I'm going to plot B over T. Let's make this nice and large. And I'm going to let this take up most of the slide so we can really see those numbers. And so here is B over T on this axis, and here is root. Here is a value of something times the root of E times Fy, E over Fy. So you'll have some dividing values, and these critical values for our case 10 here are 0.38. So we'll have 0.38 times E over Fy, or root E over Fy, and 1.0. Then, so these are basically serving as the boundaries between whether we classify a given flange as compact, non-compact, or slender. And so these are our boundaries. And depending on which region you're in, you're going to use a different section of the steel manual, of chapter F, I should say, to be more precise. So depending on what boundary you're in, or what region you're in, you're going to use a different section of chapter F. Now, we're going to be mainly concerned today about section F2, and that applies to compact. So as long as your B over T is less than 0.38 times the square root of E over Fy, this will be the fully compact region. You'll have compact flanges. If you are greater than 0.38 but less than 1.0, you'll be in the non-compact region. Non-compact. But then if you're greater than 1.0, you'll be in the slender region. You will be in the slender region. So again, these are going to serve as the boundaries between our various systems. So let's see. And again, let me just kind of remind us here. Write this down for good measure. So as long as our W section is in the compact region, we can use the criteria in section F2. Criteria in section F2. This is when section F2 fundamentally applies.
So what's the difference between a compact and a
Compact and slender, the difference between them, really it's just, the question is, what is the difference between compact, or sorry, non-compact and slender, you mean? Or compact and slender? I mean, all this means is just how slender it is. That's really all it is. If it's, think about this, if you're, as your B over T gets larger and larger and larger, so here's one B over T, here's a larger B over T. Actually, let me draw this horizontal so we could see this. So a very compact flange would look something like this. As B over T starts to get larger, my my flange starts to get wider and wider and wider relative to its thickness. And so it doesn't really intrinsically mean anything by itself. So the question is, what do these mean? Well, I can define them mathematically, but in terms of what they mean, all that it's important, as we've kind of talked about previously, with I've previously mentioned today, that this is a buckling limit state, that this basically says that depending on how wide or how slender your flanges are, you will have to worry about different failure modes. So just if you remember back in, so steel design is all based on analyzing potential failure modes. Like, so just remember, do you remember when we looked at tension members, we had things like, okay, we said, okay, this tension member can fail in a variety of ways. It can fail in just gross section yielding, it can fail in net section fracture, it can fail in block shear rupture, et cetera. And so steel members can fail, when we're checking them, they have different, what we call failure mechanisms. They have different ways of breaking apart, of yielding, of different ways of failing. And so this is going to be true for all steel shapes and all steel elements, all steel members, whether they're talking about beams, columns, et cetera. Well, okay, we're just trying to see what region we're in. That's all we're going to do. Oh. We're just trying to see what region we're in. If you go and calculate that your B over T is equal to 0.5 times the root of E over Fy, then you'll find that you're in the non-compact shape, so you'd have to use a different section in chapter F. If you found that you have a slender flange because you're above 1 times square root of E over Fy, then you have to use the slender section. So basically, the code is split up in, the chapter F is split up into a series of sections based upon the slenderness of your flange. So this is where you start. You first say, okay, well, how slender is my flange? And then depending on that, that's where you choose what section in the code you go to. That's how this works mechanically. Okay. But we're going to start with section F2 because that's the simple one, the nice friendly one. It's the one where the equations are the least scary. So anyway, it's one where the equations are hopefully the least scary. So section F2, and they can get quite scary, and we'll see some of that even in chapter F, but in section F2. So section F2 here. This describes, let's go back to section F2, and that's going to be on page 16.1-47 in the AISC steel manual. And there are effectively two limit states to consider. There are two limit states that section F2 considers. Two limit states to consider. There are two limit states to consider. One, yielding. And this is what we talked about previously. This is what I went through. This is what I sort of developed from the mechanics materials approach yesterday, or in the last lecture, talking about the development of the full plastic moment capacity of a section based purely on first mechanics materials principles, first principles for mechanics materials. And then we're going to be talking about this one today. This is sort of going to be the upper limit. This is assuming that no kind of buckling occurs. But then we also have a more complex case that we won't get to today, and that is lateral torsional buckling. Lateral torsional buckling, which is a bit more complex. Lateral torsional buckling. So I want to talk about the yielding limit state first. So here, let us look at the yielding limit state, and that is the first section in section F2. So let's talk about yielding. And that is, again, section the first state there. So the yielding limit state. Now, basically, in this kind, in yielding, we are assuming if you get complete yielding, if you get the full sort of plastic moment capacity, if you get the full plastic moment capacity out of your beam, no sort of buckling is occurring. So we're not going to worry about, say, flange local buckling, or we're not going to worry, and so the limiting thickness ratios worry about flange local buckling, but we can also have lateral torsional buckling, which is something we'll learn about next time. But so there's no sort of buckling involved. We're basically having an idealized case where we are able to completely load up the entire cross section. For the plastic limit state, if you have a W section and you're lucky enough to be able to take it all the way up to the plastic limit state, and lucky enough is a relative term here. I don't want to be standing on a beam that is undergoing this limit state. But at this point, you're basically saying that the entire cross section, every square millimeter of this thing, is going to be fully loaded up to the elastic limit. So the whole cross section gets loaded up to the plastic limit. A whole cross section is at yield stress. And this really is the absolute maximum that you're ever going to get out of a cross section, ignoring ultimate strength and strain hardening, that sort of thing. But this is the ultimate strength you're ever going to get out of a cross section. You're never going to get more than this because you are literally yielding the entire cross section from top to bottom. And yielding is, again, where you're getting more and more deformation without any additional load. So when you have the full, this is basically the full plastic moment capacity that we talked about last time. The full plastic moment capacity. This is where the entire cross section is yielding. Every single inch of this thing from top to bottom, every square millimeter, everything is giving up the ghost and saying, I can't take it. She can't take any more, Captain. We're done. We're going home. This thing's coming down. So this is the full plastic moment capacity. I don't care how you brace your beam. I don't care how you I don't care what kind of shear what kind of shear strength you have. I don't care what you do to it. Sometimes you need to add bracing and things like that, flange bracing and such, to prevent lateral torsional buckling. But this is kind of akin to in columns. Now, in columns, if you have a long, slender column, you can get buckling. But if you brace the column periodically along the way, you can prevent buckling. But even in columns, I don't care how much you brace them, you're never going to get more than the crushing strength or the yield strength of that material. And so this is very similar to that. I don't care how well you brace your compression flange, you're never going to get more than the overall plastic limit state. This is the absolute maximum the shape is ever going to be able to give you. So that's why it's kind of an upper limit for all of our other analyses. But anyway, let's look at this in terms of equations here. So I want to look at equation F2-1 and equation F2-1 defines the nominal moment capacity as equal to the plastic moment capacity. To the plastic moment capacity or I could simply say M nominal equals M plastic. Now we could actually go back in from mechanics materials and do a kind of centroidal stress analysis, which is what I did in my previous video for each one, or we can also recognize that the steel manual does thankfully have, at least for most of our shapes, has a nice section property that will allow us to calculate this very easily, and that is our Z. So we saw in last time, S is your elastic section modulus. That corresponds to the amount of bending moment capacity you have when the outermost fiber is reaching the elastic limit. Z, though, is your plastic section modulus. This is related to the kind of bending moment capacity you have if the entire cross-section, from top to bottom, every square millimeter, every square inch, all of it is yielding. So this is the plastic section modulus. And if you look in chapter, if you look back at, say, chapter one, if I were to go back to my W sections, oh, say, anywhere along them, like page 1-20, something like that, if you look there in your code, you will see that that they have, along with your I, your moment of inertia, your radius of gyration, etc., on, say, page 1-23, you can see this, they have strong axis, so that's XX, and weak axis, YY. Among those section properties they have calculated for each axis is the Z, the plastic section modulus. So this then incurs, so this is for all of our standard rolled shapes, the Z is already calculated, so things are very easy. Now, if I give you a built-up section that's made of a couple plates, you might actually have to calculate Z, and in that case, it would be a bit more complex. But for any of our off-the-shelf, predefined catalog shapes, you can simply use the code value for Z. And in fact, as we saw last time, it's actually better to use the code value for Z than the sort of mechanics materials plate calculation method, because this Z here includes all the little things that that's really hard for you to calculate, like the little fillets on where the little curvature where the flange meets the web, the little curvature at the end of the flanges, all that little slight arcs and curvature, that kind of thing. The Z listed there takes that into account, where if you're doing a Z calculation based on just rectangular plate areas, it's hard to take those into account. So what all this means, again, this is equation F2-1, and where Fy is your yield stress, Fy is going to be your yield stress, and Zx is your plastic section modulus. Exactly, yes. The plastic moment capacity is going, the overall plastic moment capacity is going to be a combination of the material, the yield strength, and the section property. So this Z basically represents geometry. It's all of the factors that the geometry contributes to the ultimate bending capacity, and the yield strength is your material strength. Okay, and just one final note here. Well, not one final note here. One final note on this slide, not one final note for today, unfortunately. Note, we're not done yet. Not even close. Note, at the full plastic capacity, the section is, this takes section right up to the full plastic yielding. Right up to full plastic yielding. Up to full plastic leading, up to fully plastically yielding. So we have permanent deformation throughout the entire cross section. Now, of course, this is not actually the true ultimate capacity. As we talked about last time, we use the whole elastic plastic assumption where we simplify the stress strain diagram of steel. So in reality, if you remember your stress strain diagrams in steel and other metals, they kind of behave more of a smooth curve like that, and then kind of have the strain hardening thing. But in our elastic plastic assumption, we're just saying, okay, well, we're not going to count on that kind of that strain hardening at the end, and we're just going to say it goes straight from at a very straight line up to the elastic stress, and then it's just horizontal from there on out. So this isn't really truly the ultimate strength of a beam, not truly the ultimate strength of the beam, but we generally don't want to rely on that strain hardening. It's very difficult to calculate. It's very unreliable. It's very dependent on, say, like the rate that you apply the load. So if you remember from, say, beam testing, things like that, or from tension tests and things like that, your actual strain capacity, the ultimate capacity, when you pull on it, yes, if you look at something in the manual, the FU, that kind of ultimate stress, that is, yes, that is a value that is produced under standardized laboratory ASTM testing conditions. So, but in the real world, the actual stress that you're going to get, that ultimate stress is going to depend heavily on the rate that you apply the loading. So if you're applying a very quick loading, you might not get that full strain hardening. You may just get failure or fracture or something. So we generally don't want to rely on that strain hardening because it's very unpredictable. So we tend to consider our ultimate capacity to be, we tend to consider the upper capacity we would ever want to rely on to be the fully plastic capacity. So anyway, so it's not really the true 100% ultimate. 100% ultimate. But we tend to use, but for bending anyway, we use F yield, the yield stress, rather than FU. Again, because FU, you're going to be concerned more with fracture, that kind of thing. Okay. All right, so I'm going to work through, I'm going to work through a very brief code example, working with the steel manual code, talking about how seeing how I would apply the equations of flange compactness, and seeing how I would then apply at least the limit state of plastic moment capacity, or yielding. Okay. So code example, quick code example here. And we have our old friends Guyven and Find, or Given and Find if you prefer. Guyven and Find. And we have, this will be given that we have a W14 by 53 made of A992 steel. And I want to find the design flexural capacity assuming lateral torsional buckling does not apply. But I'll just go ahead and assume, I'm just told that LTB does not apply. Assuming lateral torsional buckling does not apply. Assuming lateral torsional buckling does not apply. So, the first thing I need to do is to get some solution, I'm going to write solution, that's what I was thinking. So solution, the first thing I need to do is to write down some section properties. And so I'm going to go over to chapter one and get some needed section properties. Needed section properties, if I can manage to write the word needed. And the ones I'll need for this particular case are, or this particular problem, I'll need the flange width and BF here. BF, not to be confused with BFF, which is something very different. 8.06 inches. 8.06 inches. And TF, the thickness of the flange, this is going to be 0.660 inches. ZX, our plastic moment, plastic section modulus, which is going to be 87.1 inches to the third power. Inches to the third power. And of course, we also have to the side, not really a section property, but still a necessary property, and that would be our yield stress equal to 50 KSI. Questions on what any of this stuff is? Hopefully, some fairly simple section properties. Okay, so my first step is going to be to figure out whether I can actually use the section, chapter F, section 2, section F2. So that's going to be my first step. So let's run through that. I'm going to run through the compact section criteria. Now, it's going to be key to remember that, again, for this case, for this limit state, B is not the overall width of the entire flange. It's only the width of half the flange, the width of just this element that we're looking at here. When I say a flange is compact or slender, I'm not talking about the entire flange. I'm talking about just the one cantilevered portion of it from the web. So that's why we're only looking at half of it. So the first step is going to be to calculate compact section criteria. Compact section criteria. Yes.
In the steel manual, there's a row that shows the compact section criteria.
Can you tell what page? Okay. Oh yes. The question on this is whether. Okay. So actually, let's do that. Let's go to page. Let's see. What page is that on?
It's for the W shapes on the.
So let's actually find our W 14 by 53 here. So let's find that, and we'll see what the question is basically on a column related to compact section criteria, and yes, that does tend to actually be included in the W shapes. But if I go to the W14s, W14s, that's going to be on page 1-24. And if you look here on page 1-25, you'll notice that they actually have a column for compact section criteria. So that actually is the exact criteria that we're going to be looking at. Yes, that's very true. And so you could go and we could just go and grab that number. It's calculated there for us. I'd rather just go and calculate it to the side here so we can see where this is coming from. But yes, there are many cases along the way where if there are common numbers that are often calculated for section properties, they'll just go ahead and throw those in the in this table here to make your job a little bit easier. Later we'll learn to really appreciate that RTS. If you see that R sub TS on the far right there, and also that H naught, we will eventually learn to really love that column, because that RTS, to calculate that without that, and we will see how to calculate that, but to calculate it without that is a very real pain in the butt, but sometimes it can't be avoided. Okay, anyway, but I'm going to go ahead and run through the compact section criteria calculating it myself. So B over T, which would also be equal to BF divided by 2TF, or I could just say BF over 2 divided by T, or BF over 2TF. This is going to be equal to 8.06 inches divided by 2, divided by the thickness of the flange, which is 0.660 inches. And that comes to 6.106. 6.106. Now, I then need to compare this to the 0.38 root over Fy. Compare to 0.38 root over root E over Fy. And so that's going to be 0.38. times the square root of 29,000 over 50, and that comes to 9.15, if my notes here are correct. And so here, so I can then say, okay, well, 6.106 must be less than or equal to, it is less than 9.15. So that tells me that this is basically that means that my B over T is less than my 0.38 times the square root of E over Fy. So therefore, my flange is compact. And therefore, section F2 applies. Section F2 does, in fact, apply. Does indeed apply. Okay, so we're almost done. All right, moving on. So again, we have now proven that we'll be able to use the equations in section F2. If we were doing this properly, we would also calculate its lateral torsional buckling capacity, but that's a bit long, and we'll save that for another day. Okay. So finally, I want to. So next, maybe I'll use the same color I did before. Step two, Now that we know section F2 applies, apply the equation, or I can just say check for the yielding limit state. Check the yielding limit state. Okay, and this one's really not gonna be too bad. This is gonna be, okay, well I can say, Mn, the nominal capacity, is just going to be equal to the plastic moment capacity, is going to be equal to Fy, the yield stress, times Zx. And again, I wanna use Zx because this is strong X is bending. And so, then this is 50 KSI, the yield stress, times the section property, the plastic section modulus of 87.1 inches to the third power. Or this then comes to 4,385 kip inches. 4,385 kip inches. Or I can, but then of course I don't want to only have my nominal capacity, I wish to have my design capacity. And like everything else in this course, when we calculate, if we're doing LRFT philosophy, at any time if we calculate a nominal, we also then have to calculate a allowable, and so we need to multiply by our reduction factor phi. So phi mn, the design moment capacity, is going to be equal to 0.9 times mn, or 0.9 times 4,385 kip inches, and this will then equal, I can say then that phi mn is equal to 946.5 kip inches. And so again, we have proved that chapter F section 2 applies, and we've calculated this beam's capacity in terms of the yielding limit state. Now, what have we left off though? So it is important to always be aware of what we're leaving behind for right now. So what have we left out? What have we left out? Well, what have we neglected? And that's okay for today. We'll learn how to work with these others later. But what have we neglected? Well, the first one is the lateral torsional unbuckling, or LTV limit state. We'll see that later. The lateral torsional unbuckling limit state. But there's one other thing that we've ignored. Any idea what that might be? What might that be? What else have we ignored? We've looked at the bending moment capacity, but what else do we always have with beams? Shear, exactly. So we've ignored, just like in any kind of beam, I'm trying to think, can you ever have a case where you wouldn't have, yeah, I suppose if you had, I'm pretty much the only case where you would have bending without shear is if you had like sort of like a, I suppose you could have a cantilever beam with a couple on the end or something, but in almost any kind of real world beam, wherever you have a moment, you're going to have shear. So we'll also have to learn how to calculate shear, although we'll see later on that for most of our common steel shapes, our common W sections, C channels, etc., your shear very rarely, if ever, controls in those cases. All right, that'll do it for today. Thank you for watching and reviewing this, and I'll see you all shortly later, and as always, thank you.